These are Dalit women, poor and from the lowest social rank in the village. They are deciding who among the village community is the poorest and qualify for the community grain support. For them to participate in a decisive manner in such an exercise spells true empowerment. Here in this mapping of village resources, women are joined by their children in an authentic reflection of their cultural pattern, wherein children learn about the outside realities as apprentices to their parents. While the women map their resources, men sit and watch with growing realization of the capabilities of the women. This may change power relations between them. Women as planners and decision makers, and men as supporters of this process. Another changing power relationship is the one between the non-literate rural people and the educated urban people. As the rural women draw and decorate their map, the urbanites learn new realities and transfer them to their books. A reversal of the formal definition of learning. Knowledge and innovations learned from people are always acknowledged by sensitive outsiders. Failure to do so amounts to intellectual piracy. Insiders' and outsiders' knowledge, skills and resources can be combined to generate locally appropriate technologies for nature conservation, health, farming, forestry and local welfare. People participate in joint analysis, which can then lead to the formation of new local groups or the strengthening of existing ones. Strong community organization and mobilization are also features of a participatory process genuinely concerned with people's empowerment and their own local definitions of well-being and progress. Many government bureaucracies and NGOs are now using participatory methods in their field operations. But organizations which value and use people's priorities and knowledge in decision making and in program development are rare. In both government departments and NGOs, there are still strong tendencies towards uniform prescription, centralized decision making, and the over-reporting of success. Few of these organizations create conditions for staff to be participatory in their work with each other. PRA is often just confined to field visits.
You can think of a bureaucratic organization as having a strong magnetic field with a north-south magnet at the top, which is the boss, and then the other magnets at different layers oriented by that magnetic field and also reinforcing it themselves, all north-south, top-down. Now, the problem here sometimes is that someone will go out from an organization, have some training, maybe PRA training or some other sort of training, and come back and wish to be demagnetized. Having been demagnetized, they come back, though, into this magnetic field, and then they're just flipped back again. And to survive and to do well in their career, they have to go back into being strongly magnetized people with a boss above whom they obey and subordinates below to whom they give orders and targets. Now, the challenge, the institutional challenge, is to change all that, and it involves personal change. And it's very difficult for many people. We have to have bureaucracies, but they can have different cultures. They can have much more participatory cultures than they have now. It doesn't seem to be possible for a hierarchical, authoritarian bureaucracy to encourage participation in communities, because the whole style is wrong.
Teaching and management styles based on hierarchy, command and obedience, and inhibited communications clearly do not encourage relationships based on the pleasure of sharing. The adoption of participatory methods by external agencies thus needs to be linked with a process of institutional transformation that nurtures the spread of enabling attitudes and behaviors among staff. Organizational cultures need to provide opportunities and incentives to learn from experience and mistakes. Openly talking about attitudes and behavior, how and why they are sustained, is all part of a sensitive commitment to participatory learning and action.
The normal tendency to centralize, standardize, and control, which one has in bureaucracies, to decentralizing, to encouraging diversity, and to giving up power. Now, it's not really losing something to give up power. We need to find more ways in which people who are in powerful positions can gain satisfactions from handing over the stick, from giving authority to other people, and then from enjoying and taking pleasure in the capacity which they have to be creative and to do things on their own in different ways. So it's really a positive thing for those who are in positions of power to give up some of it and to empower those below them.